Welcome to Looking For. Today, we are going to talk about an important trend that is only growing, now forcing some cities and sometimes even countries to reinvent themselves. Rising waters, recurring storms, erosion, the consequences of climate change are causing numerous ecological disasters, and in the face of these climate changes, some regions are much more vulnerable than others. This is notably the case for cities and coastal countries who see the rising waters as a real threat to their existence. In order to survive, they must design protection systems ever more effective and impressive. From New York to Japan, through Venice and the Netherlands, I invite you today to an overview of these solutions. Rising waters are not a new problem. Some cities have been dealing with it for a long time already. This is the case of Venice, built in large part on stilts in a lagoon of the Adriatic Sea. The destiny of the city is intimately linked to water. If Venice has been able to shine all over the world, it is in great part thanks to its maritime superiority. But the city of the Doges remains vulnerable to a great danger, the Acqua Alta, in Italian, the equivalent of the high tide in English, a term that designates the period between autumn and spring when Venice is particularly exposed to flooding, a fragility caused by phenomena of high tides combined with other natural factors. The threat is well known, but it's constantly growing. With the rise of the waters, the Acqua Alta is more and more regular and more dangerous. On the records of the last 100 years, the majority of the largest floods occurred after 2009. Late example, in November 2019, when the largest high tide for 50 years fell on the city. The Acqua Alta reached the 2 meters, submerging nearly 85% of the city, causing with it countless material damages. Against this threat, the city has spent billions of euros to set up its defense, the Mose Project. Composed of a series of 78 mobile dikes, the project surrounds Venice and should to create a watertight border with the rest of the Adriatic Sea. The objective of the project is to ensure that the high tides do not enter the lagoon and do not flood the lower parts of the city, which are slightly below sea level. In the works since the late 1980s, the Mose Project began to be built in 2003. The first sections of this new type of dike were installed in 2008. A part of the project was tested in 2020 when an Acqua Alta threatened the city. The result was very positive because Venice was almost not submerged. However, the Mose Project should only be fully effective by December 2023. This slowness is partly due to numerous corruption scandals that have marked the history of this rampart. This defense system must allow a protection at least until the end of the century. The rise of the waters and the fear of big floods are problems that are shared by many cities around the world. This is especially true for New York City. The first thing you think of when you imagine the economic capital of the United States is its forest of skyscrapers and its spectacular architecture. But under the glass and steel canopy of these immense buildings, the city must fight against the inexorable rise of the waters. Located on the east coast of the United States, New York is frequently hit by extreme weather events. Hurricanes and storms often hit the city and flood many neighborhoods. Another threat, the Big Apple, is located at the mouth of the Hudson River, the East River, and facing the Atlantic Ocean, a geographical situation that makes it particularly vulnerable to the rising waters and flash floods. In recent history, large floods have already affected the city and especially its heart, Manhattan. We remember the Hurricane Sandy, which plunged the city into chaos in 2012. 44 people died during the event, and Sandy will have caused nearly $19 billion in property damage in the largest city of the United States. After this dramatic episode in the history of New York, the authorities became aware of the problem and undertook major works to counteract this phenomenon. In the southeast of Manhattan, along the East River, a huge anti-flood wall is taking shape. More than 4 kilometers long, it must be buried at a depth of more than 35 meters and rise above the surface of more than 3 meters. A gigantic protection which must preserve this side of the island, particularly vulnerable to the whims of the climate. This reinforced concrete wall will be able to increase in size according to the needs, a way of anticipating rising sea levels. This new wall, which should not be operational before 2026, will cost more than $1 billion. The city also plans to compensate for the green spaces destroyed during the construction by creating a new elevated park. Finally, a major effort should be made on the underground sewers and wastewater networks in order to provide a complete response to this problem. The solution of building a wall to protect against the risks of climate change seems to have been adopted in many parts of the world. While New York's barrier should initially be no more than 3 meters high, in Japan, a barrier between 10 and 15 meters high is being built. On the northeast coast of the country's main island, Honshu, a huge dam against the Pacific, is being built. Construction of this new kind of wall began in 2011. In March, an earthquake triggered a terrible tsunami that devastated much of the region, killing tens of thousands of people. The tsunami was also behind the subsequent nuclear disaster at the Fukushima power plant. On the particularly vulnerable Japanese coast, 10-meter-high anti-submergence walls had been erected before the 2011 disaster, but they failed to withstand the impact and were literally pulverized by the tsunami. Urged to react quickly after the disasters caused by this giant wave, the Japanese authorities ordered the construction of another wall, bigger, higher, and more resistant. To ward off any further disaster, the authorities decided to fortify part of the Japanese coastline. In total, over 450 kilometers of coastline have been fortified with a reinforced concrete wall up to 15 meters high in some places. An impressive dike, but one that will have to prove its effectiveness, especially if another 22-meter-high wave, as in 2011, appears on the horizon. In addition to this great wall, the Land of the Rising Sun is also exploring other avenues for dealing with the increasing number of natural disasters on its territory. In the suburbs of Tokyo, to put an end to recurrent flooding, a monumental underground water recovery system has been built. Called G-Cans, the project attracts scientists from all over the world, as well as the curious, who can visit the main water retention chamber. There's no need for flippers or snorkels, as the 177 meter long, 78 meter wide, and 25 meter high chamber can only be visited when it's dry. Since 2006, the installation of this system of over 7 kilometers of underground tunnels has prevented numerous disasters. To keep their heads above water, some are even investing on the scale of an entire country. The Netherlands is a case in point. The problem in the Netherlands is not a recent one, since over the centuries, the inhabitants of this territory wedged between Belgium and Germany have mastered the art of keeping the waves dry. Quite a feat when you consider that 26% of the land in this small state is below sea level. Without the dikes built along the coastline, almost two-thirds of the Netherlands would be flooded today. These structures are also present inland, reclaiming land from stretches of water. These areas, known as polders, account for no less than 17% of the current territory of the Netherlands. In total, the country has 22,500 kilometers of dikes, over 1,000 kilometers more than the Great Wall of China. But even such a massive infrastructure can have its flaws. In 1953, the country suffered a massive flood that claimed the lives of over 1,800 people. The Dutch government embarked on a colossal project of reconstruction and innovation that would last 40 years. The Delta Project, as it is known, is considered the world's largest defense against rising waters. It involved the construction of some 15 dams. The Rotterdam flood barrier is the flagship of this pharaonic project, comprising two arched gates, each 220 meters long and 22 meters high. The Maaslandkering, as it is known in the Netherlands, was completed in 1997. It is used to close the canal linking Rotterdam and the North Sea during storm warnings. The huge 15,000-ton steel structure has since been closed only twice, in 2007 and 2017. But rising sea levels threaten more than just the country's coastline. The Scheldt, Meuse, and Rhine rivers and some of their tributaries also cross the country on their way to the North Sea. With global warming, flooding on these rivers is set to become increasingly violent. A problem that is well understood and already partially taken care of. A case in point is Nijmegen, where the bed of the Waal, which flows into the Rhine, has been upgraded with a new arm to prevent major flooding. But despite such infrastructure, the country is facing future climate hazards with anxiety. A 2021 IPCC report reveals that 60% of the Netherlands is vulnerable to flooding, including its coastline and areas close to rivers. The cause is a faster-than-expected rise in water levels, which could rise by 2 meters by 2100. The government is planning to invest a further 20 billion euros to reinforce the Delta project and create new solutions, such as floating farms that will serve as shelters in the event of uncontrollable flooding. Faced with this global problem, solutions are beginning to emerge all over the world. However, they are difficult to transpose from one country to another, as each has its own characteristics to take into account. Above all, such infrastructures are extremely expensive, a fact that leaves many countries with relatively few resources to tackle the problem. And yet, the situation is urgent. According to the latest scientific reports, water levels will rise in all parts of the world, varying from 50 centimeters to several meters, depending on projections. But fortunately, some ambitious solutions are currently being promoted by famous architects. Such is the case of Oceanix, a floating city project by the Danish firm of Bjarke Ingels, operating in modules with an economic and conceptual model that can be transposed to most regions of the globe. Then there's the Aequorea project, a futuristic vision of underwater cities by Vincent Calabo, based on algae and recycled plastics from the sixth continent. These are encouraging projects for the future. All right, that's the end of this video. I hope you enjoyed it. Thank you for watching and see you very soon on Looking For. Goodbye.